We wake up this morning and there is military confusion in our world. No one seems to know how to deal with the ISIS crisis. We wake up this morning and there is political chaos in our nation. Protest and speeches being canceled. I'm here to tell you, our world is not falling apart. It's coming together. It's coming together just as a sovereign God planned that it would. We're in a series of messages in which that is the title. Our world is not falling apart. It's coming together. We're basing those messages in the book of Revelation. We're in chapter 4 today. We find ourselves in chapter 4 and verse 1. And so I invite you to turn in your Bible or turn on your Bible to Revelation chapter 4. Find verse 1. If you did not bring a physical copy of God's Word with you today or an electronic copy, there is a Bible in the pew rack there in front of you or down to your left or your right. And if you'll find page 1030 in that pew Bible, way over there in the back, you'll find Revelation chapter 4. And I want to begin in a moment in verse 1. We're going to look today at the fourth chapter in Revelation, a message that I'm simply entitled, A Throne and a Throng. A Throne and a Throng. Let's bow together. If you would, take a moment before I begin today and pray for me. Ask the Lord to fill me with His words today, the words that would please Him, the words that you need to hear. And then would you pray for yourself right now, sir, ma'am? Would you just ask the Lord to speak to your heart, to meet you where you are? We're all at a different place in our spiritual journey. But through the power of the Holy Spirit today, the words that I say will be spoken to you just as if they were for you. And I believe that will happen today. If you will pray and ask the Lord to speak to your heart through me today to meet your need. So pray for me. Pray for yourself. Heavenly Father, thank you for just the opportunity to sing to you today and then to hear that indeed you are Alpha and Omega. And Father, we pray today that we would hear from you, that you would open our hearts and minds to your word now, Father. Speak through me and to us all. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe by C.S. Lewis, an old wardrobe becomes a door, in fact, a magical door, into another land. And when Lucy, the main character, steps through it, she encounters a land vastly unfamiliar to her. She encounters a land full of strange creatures and never-before-seen characters. Then when Lucy comes back home, she tries to describe what she has seen, but it's difficult for others to understand the wonder of all she has experienced. In Revelation chapter 4, Jesus beckons John to come through an open door. Not an old wardrobe, but a door that stands open in heaven. And John goes through the door and thus begins a series of unusual visions and encounters with creatures and characters that can only be described as something from another world. So today we will begin our journey into John's unusual vision. Now, seldom in Scripture is the veil of heaven drawn back, enabling us to see what's there. Daniel does describe a brief look at God. Moses got a glimpse of God, actually the afterglow of God, on Mount Sinai. And as Stephen was being stoned to death, he looked up and he said that he saw a door in heaven open and Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. However, in John's vision, we get the clearest picture of heaven and what will be taking place during the tribulation period. Now, some might picture heaven as a beautiful golf course where you never slice the ball and all your putts roll in. Some might picture heaven as a beautiful lake where you can ski for miles or where there is always a bass on the other end of your line. Some might think of heaven as a place where we float on fluffy clouds playing a harp and eating candy bars all day long. However, what's going to catch your attention is heaven is not the scenery. What's going to catch your attention in heaven is not what you are doing. It's not something. It's someone. And he is seated on a throne. Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1 says, "After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, 'Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' At once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, and one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow." Now let me just stop and say that 12 times in this chapter you're going to read the words "the throne, the throne, the throne." 12 times the throne is mentioned in this chapter. It's what attracts our attention. There is one seated on a throne. Over 40 times in the book of Revelation itself, the word "the throne" is used. And he who sat there, verse 3 says, had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. And around the throne were 24 thrones and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. And from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumbling and peals of thunder." You didn't know there were East Texas thunderstorms in heaven, did you? "And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there were, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before Him who is seated on the throne and worship Him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'Worthy are You, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created.'" Look back in verse 1. Verse 1 is an image, a picture of the rapture of the church out of this world. "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. Now, if you remember our outline from Revelation chapter 1 in verse 19, let me just remind you of that. You might want to turn back to that. Revelation chapter 1, verse 19, John is told, "Write therefore the things which you have seen, those that are, and those that are to take place after this." And when we looked at that verse, we said that's an outline of the whole book of Revelation. When John was told to write the things that he has seen, that's chapter 1. That's the vision of a resurrected Lord Jesus. And when John was told to write the things that are, that's chapters 2 and 3, the seven historical churches, representing churches of all the ages, every one of them having conditions that are present in every church throughout the ages, things that Jesus commended and things that Jesus corrected. Chapters 2 and 3, those letters to the seven churches, those things that are. But after that it says, "And then write those things that are to take place after this." That's Revelation chapter 4 to the end of the book, Revelation chapter 22. Revelation 4 to 22, all taking place in the future, the things that take place after this. In fact, verse 1 of chapter 4 has the exact same language. "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." So, from Revelation chapter 4 till the end of the book, we are going to see things that are yet to happen. We are going to see things that are in the future. There's going to be a seven-year tribulation period described here in the book of Revelation. Then in chapter 19, there's going to be the second coming of our Lord Jesus. And then in chapter 20, there is going to be a thousand-year reign with Jesus upon this earth of believers. And then after that, the Lord is going to start all over, I believe, because Revelation chapter 21 speaks of a new heaven and a new earth. But before we get to see what's going to take place on earth, that actually doesn't begin till chapter 6. We're going to see what is taking place in heaven. Because John is going to show us, in other words, John was showed first what is taking place in heaven during the tribulation period. That's chapters 4 and 5. And so we begin today by looking at chapter 4. This is, again, after the rapture of the church. In fact, the Sunday after Easter, April the 3rd, we are going to look extensively at the rapture of the church. And we will look at the opening days of the tribulation and what they are going to be like. But for today, we concern ourselves with heaven. We concern ourselves with John's vision of heaven and what is going to take place right after the rapture, and what is going to take place in heaven while the tribulation period is taking place here on the earth. And there are two realities that I want to center our thoughts around this morning: a throne and a throng. So let's begin our life point with these words this morning: a holy God on a heavenly throne. A holy God on a heavenly throne. Verse 2 tells us that one is seated there on a throne. It shows us God seated on a throne as the absolute sovereign of our world. Here is a true picture of our world. Our world is not falling apart. It is coming together. Every event that we see happening today is under the hand of a sovereign God. Verse 8 tells us that the one seated on that throne is the Lord God Almighty. He is the one that has made everything happen. He is the source of all that has taken place and all that will take place on this earth. Now, I find it interesting that John doesn't make any attempt to describe the Lord God Almighty. But he tells us simply that he has the appearance, verse 3, he has the appearance of jasper and carnelian. Now, jasper is a precious gem. It is translucent. In other words, it lets light through it. Jasper is crystal, perhaps even a diamond. And the words suggest qualities of the one who sits on the throne: his purity, His majesty. Carnelian is a blood red stone, suggesting royalty or even the fire of judgment. It's a holy God on a heavenly throne. Then notice around the throne there was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Now I'm told that every pilot knows that rainbows are actually complete circles, and that this rainbow is around the throne. The rainbow suggests mercy. The rainbow being given to Noah as a promise, a sign of God's mercy. So here we have a God who is pure, majestic. Here we have a God who is royal, or even has judgment in his character. Here we have a God also, though, who is a God of mercy. And verse 5 says, from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. Those are common manifestations of the presence of God in the Old Testament. They suggest his power. They suggest his glory. And verse 6 says, before the throne there were, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. The words suggest a distance. A distance that separates a holy God from a fallen world. A sea of glass like crystal. Suggesting that God in his holiness is separated from a sinful, evil world. Indeed, a holy God on a heavenly throne. But let me show you something. Don read it just a moment ago. He read Revelation chapter 21. Just listen. Know that it's found in Revelation 21, but listen to these words. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. Now, where did the sea go? Where did the sea go? The sea that we see in Revelation chapter 4 is not there in Revelation chapter 21. And the sea was no more. The separation was no more. The separation between God and his creation, the separation between a holy God and his people is gone. Because in Revelation chapter 21, verse 2 says, I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. You see, there's coming a day when there will be no more sin. There will be no more separation. God is going to live among us as our God, and we as his people. And there won't be any mourning, suffering, pain. Back to Revelation chapter 4. Let me touch on two more images around the throne. Verse 5 says, before the throne there was burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. This is the Holy Spirit, represented in his fullness. And then there are four creatures. Verse 6 says, there were four creatures, four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature, like a lion, the second like an ox, the third like the face of a man, the fourth like an eagle in flight. Ezekiel saw the same creatures. In Ezekiel chapter 1 and Ezekiel chapter 10, you can read about these same creatures. They are cherubim. They are a specific angelic order. Commentators vary as to their features. Full of eyes. What does that mean? Some commentators believe that it means that it represents their vigilance, that nothing escapes their notice, that they have constant awareness Their appearance is like that of a lion, an ox, a man, and an eagle. Pull five commentaries off your shelf, you'll get five different opinions as to what that means. Let me just give you the best two. Each one represents a different aspect of the created order. The lion represents the wild beast. The ox represents the domesticated animals. The man obviously represents human beings. And the eagle represents all the flying creatures. And then another commentator suggests that they represent what is noblest in creation, the lion. What is strongest in creation, the ox. What is wisest in creation, the man. What is swiftest in creation, the eagle. Descriptions vary as to what these four images mean, a lion, an ox, a man, and an eagle. But while their descriptions seem to defy explanations, their purpose is very clear. Day and night, they never stop saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Without pause and without rest, these winged cherubim, "Holy is the Father, holy is the Son, holy is the Spirit, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." It is indeed a holy God on a heavenly throne. Notice that the throne is the center of all the activity. Whether it's the elders, and we're going to get to them in just a moment, whether it's the elders or the living creatures or the sea of glass or the rainbow, it all centers around the throne and the one who sits on it. Dear friend, here is a picture of a holy God on a heavenly throne. He is sovereign of the universe. The first thing John wants us to know about heaven is that there is one seated on a throne, and praise and honor are to be given to this one who sits on the throne, because he rules and he reigns and he raises up kingdoms and he puts down governments. I chuckled when I studied this week in preparation for this marriage, preparation for this message, because I pulled out some of my notes from previous trips that I've made through Revelation. I've preached through Revelation before, and I found this quote. When I came to this verse, I think it was the second time I preached through Revelation. Don't know exactly when that was, but here's what I wrote. God is sovereign in history. Whether the ruler is George Bush, Mikhail Gorbachev, or Manuel Noriega, whoever it may be, all are subject to the hand of a sovereign God. Now, are any of those guys still ruling? Not at all. But who's still on his throne? The names have changed, but the one on his throne remains the same. He rules, he reigns, he raises up kingdoms, and he puts down government. And I just want to stop and say, have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the way you have trod. Never alone are the least of his children. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. He's on his throne. Have faith in God. He watches o'er his own. He cannot fail. He must prevail. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Though all else fail about you, have faith in God. He provides for his own. He cannot fail. Though all kingdoms shall perish, he rules and reigns upon his throne. Have faith in God. A sovereign, holy God on a heavenly throne. Now, we're not finished. There's more to learn. Our life point is not complete, so we need to complete it. Here's the rest of it. A holy God on a heavenly throne calls for unending praise from an everlasting throng. A holy God on a heavenly throne calls for unending praise from an everlasting throne. from an everlasting throne. Now, we haven't identified the 24 elders yet, at least not in this sermon. If you look in verse 4, around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their head. And verse 9 tells us that whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who's seated on the throne, that the 24 elders fall down before Him who is seated on the throne and worship Him who lives forever and ever. And they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are You, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created." Now again, commentators vary as to exactly who these 24 elders are. Let me tell you who I believe they are. I believe they represent redeemed humanity. I believe they represent all of redeemed humanity. I believe the 24 is two divisions of 12, obviously. I think the 12 tribes of Israel representing all of the saints of the Old Testament. I believe it refers to the 12 apostles of the Lamb representing all the saints of the New Testament. So you have the Old Testament people of God and you have the New Testament people of God here around the throne in heaven. It's us. It's us. It is the raptured church, along with all the saints of the ages around that throne for 7 years, while all hell literally is breaking forth on earth, around the throne of God in heaven are the saints of the ages, the raptured church with the Old Testament and the New Testament saints. Abraham is here, David is here, Daniel is here, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, they're all here. Peter is here, and James is here, and John is here, and Paul is here. They're all here. William Tyndale is here, and Martin Luther is here, and John Calvin is here, and John Wesley is here, and George Whitfield is here, and Charles Spurgeon is here, and D.L. Moody is here, and Billy Graham is here, and Pepper Purrier is here. Did I name all the great preachers? Did I miss anybody? Seriously, the saints of all the ages are here. Well-knowns and unknowns, they're all here. Your grandparents are here. Your father is here. My mom is here. Your child is here. And one day, you're going to be there. Notice what you're wearing. You're wearing a white garment, representing purity and holiness. Now, did you get that white garment by being more good than bad when you were alive on earth? Your good outweighed your bad. Did you get that white garment by behaving? Did you get that white garment by living right? Did you get that white garment by coming to church on time, even on Spring Forward Sunday? Did we get purity and holiness by our own efforts? No, no, no. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. This garment is the righteousness of Christ, which covers your sin. And by the way, when we baptize people, what do we put on them? White robe. White robe. quite a picture of symbolism there. Okay, you're wearing a white robe. You know what you got on your head? A golden crown. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. We're wearing a white robe, and we have a golden crown on our heads. Some of you are going to look pretty funny. White robe, golden crown on our heads. What are we doing? What are we doing? Verse 9. And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders, there we are, fall down before Him who is seated on the throne and worship Him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are You, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to Him all majesty ascribe and crown Him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at His feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown Him Lord of all." Here's the point I want to make this morning. I want this passage to call us to better worship now. Do you see what the Life Point says? A holy God on a heavenly throne calls for unending praise from an everlasting throng. We serve a holy God who is seated this morning on a throne. And that calls for our worship. It calls for our praise. And how we worship Him now is preparing us for how we will worship Him then. How we worship today prepares us for how we worship for all eternity. The love and adoration that you have in your heart now is only going to be multiplied when you get up there. Sometimes down here, we're slow to enter into, we are slow to enter into an attitude of worship. We just sort of go through the motions, mumble through the songs. Dear family, our worship today ought always to be nothing less than a rehearsal for the day when we enter the heavenly worship described here. So look again at these verses. As I call us to be better worshipers today based on what I see worship like in heaven. Here's what praise and worship looks like. It is to be focused. Worthy are You, our song is going to say. Worthy are You, our Lord and our God. Our worship in this room on Sunday is to be focused on the One who sits on the throne, the eternal God. It's not about us. We're not sitting, standing, thinking about what the person beside us thinks. We are focused on the Almighty Lord God. He's the audience. You see, here's the wrong picture of worship that you have in your mind. Here is the wrong picture of worship that you have in your mind. You think you are the audience. You think Fred and I and the choir are the performers. And you think Ann and Dorinda are the prompters to worship. They start playing, you stand up and sing. They've prompted us, it's time to do that. You're the audience. Fred and I and the choir are the performers. Ann and Dorinda just the prompters. That's the wrong picture of worship you have in your head. Here's the right picture of worship that you need to get in your head. God is the audience. He's the only one we ought to be focused on Sunday morning. God is the audience. You are the performers. And the Holy Spirit is the prompter. God's the audience. We're the performers. The Holy Spirit is the prompter. Praise is focused. And when we enter this room on Sunday morning, let us be focused on Him. Second thing praise is, it is moving. The elders fall down. The elders cast their crowns before the throne. The elders confess, "Worthy are you, our Lord and our God." Praise is to be moving. It is a moving experience. It is to be heartfelt and spontaneous. It is to be emotional. It is to literally be wrung from your heart every Sunday. You ought to be changed by the time you leave here. You ought to be affected. You ought to be moved. I pray every Sunday that you will not leave the same way that you came in, but that you will leave moved. You will leave changed, challenged, convicted, encouraged, enlightened, something, but just not the same way you came in. Worship is to be moving, and then it's to be theologically sound. In praise, you have to get your theology right. We don't have any more right to sing falsehood than I do to preach falsehood. And so it's got to be theologically sound. In this passage alone, we see that God is sovereign, God's almighty, God's the one who redeems, God is the one who is eternal, God is the one who's worthy of glory and honor, God is the one who creates. All of those theological themes are in this passage. It is to be theologically sound. And then finally, it is not silent. Do you know there's going to be a lot of noise in heaven? We have living creatures speaking, elders singing, lightning flashes, thunder peals, lamps are blazing. Heaven is full of sights and sounds. Ceaseless praise that is not silent. I've been waiting to say this all morning. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Early in the morning our song shall rise to Thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty. God in three persons. Blessed Trinity. Listen to the second verse. Holy, 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 all the saints adore Thee. Casting down, that's verse 10, their golden crowns, that's verse 4. Around the glassy sea, that's verse 6. Cherubim, that's verse 8. And seraphim falling down before Thee, who wert and art and evermore shall be. That's the response we must leave with this morning. We must bow our lives before the King of the universe. I'm talking about the absolute surrender of all that you are. I'm talking about the absolute surrender of all that you have to the one who is seated on the throne this morning. What you once thought of as your time and your money and your talents and your career, no, friend, it's all His. Is there anything in your life that you have not submitted to the sovereign God? And let me ask you this. Does He hold the same place in your heart that He holds in heaven? Seated on the throne. The wisest, most intelligent, move you could ever make is to surrender all that you are and all that you have to the one who loves you like no one else could ever love you and is in control of everything. We have to bow before the one who is seated on the throne this morning. Let's do that. Let's bow. Heavenly Father, thank you today for a glimpse of heaven. May it forever be implanted in our hearts and in our minds that first and foremost, heaven, Father, is you seated on a throne. And there's a lot of things we need to do in response to that, but not until we do the first thing, and that is to bow our hearts, our heads, our tongues, our lips, our mouth, our will to you, O God. The one who is worthy to receive glory and honor and power. And so in the quietness of this moment, as best we know how, we bow before you. And everything we have and all that we are, we give to you, who loves us like no one else could ever love us, Father, and who is in control of our lives. That's the move we make this morning, Lord. That's the change. We bow all that we are and have and give it to you. In Christ Jesus' name, the one who clothes us in white robes, his righteousness. It's in his name I pray. Amen. Amen. For some of you, in a moment you'll want to come and literally bow before the Lord God and do business with him around this altar. If you want to come and join First Baptist Church, this is one of the times and one of the ways that you can officially become a member of our church, and we would rejoice in having you be a part of our family today. If that's your desire, in just a moment when we sing, and you'll just come down the aisle and take my hand or the hand of my staff and tell us your desire to be a part of our family. But for some of you, the first step in bowing is to believe. It is to believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sin. And you need to repent, turn from the sin in your life, and confess Christ. And today's the day. Today's the day the Spirit's tugging at your heart. Today's the day the Spirit is moving within you, and you're gonna be saved today. Because you're not only going to bow, you're going to believe. As quietly as you can, let's all stand, please. and we're going to sing. If you would believe today, you come down an aisle and just share with me.